You're watching TSN, the sports network, your number one source for sport news.
Here it is, the first pitch in Blue Jay history. It's a strike for the fastball.
There's a drive to George Bell. He's got it. Come in. He's there. He's got it. The Blue Jays have won it. The Jays have won it. They've won the Eastern Division Championship.
Sure, the Toronto Blue Jays have had to wait a while. few cracks before they finally made it to the World Series, but the Braves have been there 2 years in a row and not been able to put it away, and Bobby Cox has been at the helm for both of those years. Bobby Cox in pretty good company for managers who have lost 2 years in a row in the World Series. A couple who popped to mind right off the top of my head. Tommy Lasorda would be one. Sparky Anderson would be another. But you have to feel for Bobby Cox, although I'm sure in his heart he feels a little bit of pride in the Toronto Blue Jays organization. He was an architect of getting this organization and this winning team together. The celebration is on. The Toronto Blue Jays 1992 World Series champions, and we will continue on this special edition of Baseball Tonight in a moment.
Tonight, 16 years to glory, brought to you by Labatt Blue. Honest and true, you bet it's blue. By Diet Pepsi, you've got the right one, baby, uh-huh. By CIBC, Bank of the World Champions. And by Mazda, it just feels right.
Big League Baseball comes to Toronto as the Blue Jays begin their inaugural season at Snowy Exhibition Stadium. The first pitch from Bill Singer, a strike, and that was a great omen. A rookie first baseman named Doug Ault wrote his name prominently into Blue Jays history by swatting the team's first home run.
Front field, hard hit ball, power alley, left center field, home run!
Ault hit two home runs that day and led Toronto to an 8-5 win. Managed by Roy Hartsfield, the Jays went 54-107 that year, but they drew over 1.7 million fans. The process of building a champion had started. Let's go now back to Buck Martinez. He is in Atlanta. He was on the field talking to players as soon as the game was over. Buck?
Candy Maldonado, another big hit for you tonight.
Well, yes, thank God. You know, like you saw me yesterday working with Larry, taking some SWP. We stay there, we work, and it was one big hit. You know, they came at the right time, and I just thank the Lord that, you know, I had the opportunity again to do something, you know, and it was a great series, you know. You have to give a lot of credit to the Braves. You know, they play us tough in this type of game, and I was more disappointed in that throw to home plate. You know, I hesitated a little bit, and the grass was wet, but thank God the guys, you know, picked me up. And
you had a little emotion going, I'm sure, trying to throw that runner out at the plate.
Oh, yes, I did. You know, I hesitated a little bit. I wanted so bad, and then, you know, the ball just slipped out of my hands. And I guess, you know, this was destiny. You know, that was supposed to be, I was the lead, we can win the game.
What about Cito Gaston? I know you pay a lot.
That's my dad. Don't worry. That's my dad. He's the man. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have been here. You know, I love him. I love him. And I'm sure now everybody loves him, too. They can see the kind of manager that he is. He deserves this.
You guys are champions, number one.
We are number one.
It really was Canada's team in the series in the truest sense of the word. Lots of Canadian flags in the field being waved by fans at the games. But we do come back to Toronto right now and put our focus into the heart of this city where the party is carrying on. Here's Vic Router.
Well, Paul, with a little help from our friends, we've got a bit of a party going on here in downtown Toronto. It has come to a complete standstill here on Yonge Street between Carlton, where Maple Leaf Gardens is to the north of us, and really the downtown core, which is south of Girard towards Dundas, Queen, and the Eaton Center. Now, the early estimate was upwards of around 200,000 people. Now, one policeman says it has topped 300,000, maybe getting closer to 400,000 people. And so far, that has been all in very good fun. Yeah, the party has begun. The World Series champions, the Toronto Blue Jays. Paul?
One guy in the thick of all the action, however, is Buck Martinez. He is in Atlanta covering the series for us. Buck is in the dressing room talking to a few players, and I understand standing by with Buck Martinez is Kelly Gruber. Buck?
Kelly Gruber.
Contributed in this World Series.
Whoever gets the MVP, which I think Bed Borders should, I think everybody deserves it. Everybody had a say-so somewhere along the way, and that's what makes a championship team, and that's what we are. We're number one, Toronto. Number one. World champ!
So the Toronto Blue Jays win the game by a score of 4-3. They take the World Series by a margin of 4-2. Lots more still to come in this special edition of baseball tonight. 16 years to glory, 16 years to a World Series title for the Toronto Blue Jays. We'll be right back. The beginning of a new decade saw the Jays make their first managerial change. Bobby Maddox was hired to replace Roy Hartsfield. Trades brought new faces Damaso Garcia, Barry Bonnell, and Joey McLaughlin to Toronto. Garcia was installed as the everyday second baseman. He meshed with Alfredo Griffin, and the two formed a pretty nifty double play combination. John Mabry set a team record with 30 home runs that year, and Otto Velez thrilled the hometown fans with a 4-home-run, 10-RBI performance in a doubleheader sweep over Cleveland. The Jays finished with their best record to date, 67 wins and 95 losses, a long way from the World Series, but still, you could feel the best was yet to come.
You know, Diet Pepsi's now for everyone. That's right, Ray. Meet my twin brother, Irv.
And our twin, Peter Urbanks.
With caffeine-free Diet Pepsi, I get all that great taste, but there's no caffeine. Sing it, brother.
You got the right one, baby. It's irresistibly sippable, uncongestibly tasteable, and caffeine-free. You got the right one, baby.
Who's 100%
The 92 Mazdas are disappearing fast. Now get automatic transmission or equivalent credit on quality 92s, like the sleek MX-5 Miata, the enormously spacious MPV, the frisky, fun-loving 323, the surprising protege, and a whole herd of Mazda trucks. So for this great offer backed by the Mazda Leadership Warranty, save them before they're gone for good.
Special year. It was that year that will always be remembered fondly by the Blue Jays fans. The Jays made two big trades, dealing Alfredo Griffin and Dave Collins to Oakland for Bill Cottle, while sending Jim Gott and two minor leaguers to San Francisco for Gary Lavelle. That allowed Dennis Lamb to stay in the middle relief, and he responded with a sparkling 11-0 record. Jimmy Key was moved from the bullpen to the starting rotation, where he posted 14 wins against only 6 losses. Perhaps the biggest surprise came from AAA Syracuse, where a little-known pitcher named Tom Henke made the best of his call-up, going 3-3 with 13 saves. That brings us to Saturday, October the 5th, and we all remember this moment. The Blue Jays won the AL East in just their 9th season. From there, it was on to the ALCS, where they jumped out to a 3-1 lead over the Royals, only to see the Royals storm back to win 3 straight. Toronto took a big step in 1985, though, falling just 1 win away from the World Series. On in the Sky Dome as soon as the game ended. Folks pour out onto the field, fireworks exploding overhead. It wasn't like 1985 at all. And then the celebration taking its natural progression, which was onto the field. And after it was on the field for a while, the celebration carrying on outdoors and up Yonge Street, where the revelers continue to celebrate in the heart of downtown Toronto, the first Canadian-based team ever to win a World Series championship, the 1992 edition of the Toronto Blue Jays. And the game was broadcast live at the Sky Dome up on the large television they have here, the Jumbotron. 45,000 people were packed into the Sky Dome to watch it. Everybody getting together to watch TV. This was the largest living room in the nation, I guess, for one night. And there were a couple of funny things that happened. Obviously, there were huge cheers when Dave Winfield got the key hit, and when Jimmy Key came on to pitch, and when Pat Borders was named as the series MVP. But one of the biggest cheers of the night went up in the 10th inning when there was a shot of Jeff Reardon, the Atlanta reliever, the beleaguered Atlanta reliever, getting up to warm in the bullpen. Reardon, of course, had been knocked around by the Toronto Blue Jays in games 2 and 3 of this series. He took the loss in one of those games, gave up the game-winning RBI in another game. They showed Reardon warming in the bullpen. Huge, massive cheer went up, people hoping that the Atlanta Braves would bring him in. They never did, but it turned out not to be necessary from a Toronto point of view. Buck Martinez is down in Atlanta. He's had a chance to talk to a number of players. He was on the field to get reaction immediately upon the ending of the game. He is in the dressing room with Pat Borders, the series MVP. What a series he had.
Last year you were fighting for playing time. This year you played every day more than any catcher in the American League, and you're ending up the MVP of the World Series. You've come a long ways, kiddo.
Well, I appreciate that, but you know, it's a shame that people like Devon White with a game-saving catch in Toronto, Dave Winfield with his game-winning hit tonight and his leadership through the whole year, Jack Morris with his leadership through the whole year, Kelly Gruber, some clutch home runs, Maldonado. So many people deserve that. It's a shame they'd even give it to one person.
What about the balance of the attack? Again tonight, it really showed up.
All the way through the lineup, we got guys that can, go get the home runs and, hit the extra base hits all the way down to Manny Lee. It's a great, great hitting lineup, a great defensive lineup, and our pitching depth is unbelievable right now.
You shot down Otis Nixon on a curveball. Tell us about that throw.
Well, David gave me you got to give credit to David. He gave me plenty of time to throw him out. And all I was trying to do is get it down there in the air, not let him get to third base.
What about your hitting in this series? You really must have been swinging, seeing the ball, everything working right for you at the plate. You swung a hot bat all series long.
Well, you go into the streaks, just like throwing bat at second base. You get to the hitting streaks where everything seems to go your way. A couple feet either way, I don't get any hits at all. So I got to look at it that way.
What about the emotions? You had to be on a high, and then Otis Nixon hits that ball in through left field. Your heart had to fall to the bottom of your shoes right then.
It did. That was a scary time because we're at their crowd's really pumping them up. You start hearing it in the later innings especially. They got real loud, and it's definitely to their advantage.
What did you think when Devo got hit and then Robbie came through with a base hit? All of a sudden, you had the heart of your order right where you wanted them.
I liked our odds at that point. Joe Carter and Dave Winfield, they were definitely due for a big hit. Joe just missed hitting a home run, and Winfield stayed back well, and I believe it was a 3-2 changeup, and hit it for a double, scored a couple runs, which we both needed both of them.
Well, you got a lot of time to enjoy being world champs. Congratulations.
Thank you, Buck.
An absolutely tremendous moment for everybody involved with the Toronto Blue Jays organization, no doubt. But just to put a bit of a bittersweet slant on things, you have to feel for Dave Steeb, Toronto Blue Jays pitcher, the winningest pitcher in the history of the franchise. What great contributions he's made to this organization over the course of his career. But Steeb on the sidelines, on the DL because of an injury, not able to participate in the biggest series ever for the team. He's with Buck Martinez.
There's a couple of old-time Blue Jays that got to be enjoying this day. Long time coming, huh, Dave Steeb?
Very long, Buck. We were waiting for this day 4 or 5 days ago, and it's finally come, and I'm almost speechless. It's just just numb running out there and falling down, getting piled on, just numb, just trying to take it all in that we really did win it.
Alfredo, it's kind of fitting that you were on the field when it was all over with.
Yes, it feels good because at least I do something. I make an error, but that's okay.
We win it.
I feel part of the team. That's great. You know, I'm really happy for me to win a World Series here with Toronto, a team that gave me the opportunity to play in the big league.
You have some deep roots with this organization. This has got to be a tremendous feeling for you.
Oh, yes. I worked my tail off this year. It's great. You know, it worked.
All right. Congratulations, Alfredo.
Thank you.
And from Atlanta, we take you to Vancouver. David Pratt is standing by. And David, I'm wondering how the celebration that's on right now compares to the enthusiasm shown for the Vancouver Canucks during their playoff run.
This is bigger and better than anything I've ever seen in this market. And it's interesting, what's going on right now is that even though it's a little crazy here, what is also going on here, what is also going on is the same type of thing that's going on in Toronto, where a lot of people are starting to spill out into the streets. And I don't know if you can hear much of this, but it's bigger and better than anything else that we've seen in this city, and I think it's bigger and better than anything else we've seen in this country.
All right, thanks a lot, David. Try to stay out of trouble. Lots going on in Vancouver and lots going on all across the country. And we're going next, I'm told, now back to Atlanta. Joe Carter is among the celebrants in the Toronto Blue Jays dressing room. He is standing by. Buck Martinez is down there. Rod Smith is also down there covering for TSN.
What was going through your mind when you caught it?
You know, I had the premonition for a long time that I was going to make the last out. I said, I'm playing first base. I said, the last out, I'm just going to be in my glove, and I wasn't going to give the ball up. Tim Lund talked me out of it, but I said, hey, you deserved it. You went out there and got the big out when we had to.
And you gave him the ball.
Yeah, I gave him the ball. I mean, Otis stepped on my feet at first base, but, I mean, to catch the ball and know we're world champions, it's exciting. I mean, I thank God because, you know, we battled the whole year long, and this is what baseball is all about.
Joe, when you first got traded from San Diego, you must have been wondering what you're getting into. It must make things so worthwhile.
Well, I knew what I was getting into. I knew we had a great ball club in Toronto, had some great teams, and I knew I would have a chance very soon to play for a world championship team. And, you know, the first year, the All-Star game, the playoffs, and now a little bit further, you know, another All-Star game, playoffs, and now the World Series, and we're champs. I mean, this is what it's all about. I was very happy that I did get a chance to play in Toronto, and hey, this makes it all worthwhile.
What does it mean for Canada and Toronto to win it for those people in the whole country there?
And, I mean,
and to be the first champion. You know?
They feel as good as we feel right now. I mean, we're going to enjoy this together. I mean, they were our 10th man. You know, the Prime Minister, Dave Winfield, he went out there. He got the fans pumped up the second half of the season. They came through for us. I'm kind of upset. We didn't win it at home to celebrate in front of the fans. But, I mean, it's going to be some great day tomorrow in Canada when we get back on that airplane. I mean, this is exciting. I was drained out there. By the third inning, I was completely exhausted. It's like you had nothing left, but we never gave up. And, hey, we're going to have a great time, and I'm going to cherish this for the rest of my life.
Joe, is it fitting Dave Winfield drove it in here?
Yeah, it was fitting. I mean, the guy, you know, he had the label in October, what was Steinbrenner put on him, and it wasn't right. You know, he hadn't had the extra base hit. We left a lot of guys on base. But he came through. I said, Big Dave's going to do it. 3-2. He comes through with a big hit down the left field, down the third base line. Double. I mean, 2-run score. I mean, what more can you ask for?
Congratulations.
All right.
Rod Smith and Buck Martinez down in Atlanta. We'll have more reaction from the Blue Jays locker room and the celebration a little bit later on as well. It's more reaction from all across Canada as our cross-country celebration tour continues in TSN. Great to have you along for the ride. Bobby Cox returned to Atlanta, and the Toronto Blue Jays promoted third base coach Jimmy Williams to the post of manager. Jesse Barfield and George Bell each drove in 108 runs. Barfield set a team record. He had 40 home runs. Tony Fernandez played every game at shortstop. He hit .310. Both Barfield and Fernandez were rewarded for their fielding prowess by collecting gold gloves that year. The big pitching surprise came from Mark Eichhorn, a rookie reliever. He finished 14-6 and had 10 saves with a stingy 1.72 ERA. In July of that year, Toronto traded pitcher Doyle Alexander for young pitching prospect Dwayne Ward. The Blue Jays won 86 games, but in a competitive AL East, that was only good enough for fourth place.